had Kyoji's bio, and I was just going to read it, but I thought I'd put together a story. I thought this would be more interesting. Reverend Kyoji Koko was born on March 1st, 1968. He's the second son of our principal mediator, Peggy, and this is Eiko Koko. And this is the story I put together. The story starts in the 1930s with my mom's parents, Sinkichi and Ume Nishimura, who traveled from Japan to America for a new and better life. They and their family of four girls and two boys managed a 36-room, single-room Lane Hotel at 711 Lane Street in the International District of Seattle. During these years, non-U.S. citizens couldn't own the hotel or the land, but could run the hotel business. It's my understanding that the hotel would provide a gathering place for Tonko believers and a place where they could conduct their services. The oldest daughter, Haruko, was sent back to Japan to live and study. And the photo on the left is her at the Faith Training Center and at the headquarters in 1937, and that's us 75 years later in 2013 at the same location. Her oldest brother, Yoshi Yoshido, he passed away young, and he's also at the headquarters and was visiting Haruko in Japan in 1937. Now, the problem was the Japanese attacked Pearl Harbor on December 7th, and America entered World War II. And Executive Order 1966, on February 19, 1942, that declared all the areas of the U.S., declared the areas of the U.S. military zones on the West Coast, and allowed the U.S. government to intern 120,000 ethnic Japanese who lived on the West Coast, and put them in remote inland internment camps. My mom and dad were placed in Minidoka. They were in the Seattle area, and they were placed in Minidoka in about 1942. This is my grandmother and the girls, and the oldest brother. And this is in camp in Minidoka by the barrack. My dad, he was in Minidoka. He joined the 442. And as you know, 442 is the most decorated military unit of its size. Received the Congressional Gold Medal in 2011. The picture on the left is in at Camp Shelby, Mississippi. And then the other picture is a portrait in East France after fighting in the Rhinelander campaign in northeastern France by Germany. Right after this picture was taken, they were sent back to Italy, broke through the Gothic line, and the war ended, and Italy was liberated. This is the Congressional Gold Medal that was given out in Washington, D.C. My grandfather died in 1945, and they held a service. I think it was at Minidoka, and it was performed by a Konko minister. This is the post-war years. They finally ruled that the relocation camps were illegal, and they closed it at the end of 1945. My mom and her sister and the rest of the family relocated to Chicago to start a new life. And my dad's family also relocated to Chicago to start a new life. They didn't go back to Washington, the state of Washington. My mom and dad married. Actually, this is at the University of Chicago where they got married and they started a new life together. Many of the Konko ministers were sent to study at Meadville Lombard Theological School in Chicago. At that time, it was located near the University of Chicago. Now it's located in downtown. Because of my mom's family involvement in the religion back in Seattle, they kept in touch with many of the ministers that came to Chicago. I used to pick up the ministers on Sunday here at the University of Chicago and have them come over for a home-cooked meal. This is how we met Reverend Alfred Tsuyuki. Michio Araki was a religious scholar who studied and was a lecturer at the University of Chicago in the 60s and 70s and was a science and engineering professor in Japan in 1976. In June 13, 1992, at my brother's birthday party, Michio brought along a 24-year-old newly ordained minister who had just arrived from Japan. Yet he had a mustache and a beard. He graduated from the Department of Literature, Shinto Branch in
Kokugaku
University. Kiyoshi remained in the U.S. and studied at Meepo Lombard for a year and a half, from May 1992 to December 1993. We met again 20 years later in the headquarters in the main worship hall to attend the grand ceremony to celebrate this passing of the Ikikami Konko Daijin's spiritual birthday. He no longer had a mustache, he no longer had black hair, and he didn't have a beard. I learned upon returning to Japan, he continued as a staff member at the Research Institute, continued to have increased responsibility, increased leadership roles. He was assigned to the Church Affairs Department and the Administrative Office of Konkyoko Headquarters. Since 2004, he has done his duties as Deputy Manager of the Worship Hall Affairs Department. He also serves as President of both the Konkyoko Scout Council and the Konkyoko Boys and Girls Association on the Sacred Grounds. He and his wife, Mariko, have 5 children, and actually his third son, Keishi, is Kyoji Sensei considers Chicago his second home. Please welcome him back. It is my honor and privilege to introduce our keynote speaker, Reverend Kyoji Konko. He's accompanied on his trip to Chicago by his third son, Keishi.
Thank you very much, Tim. Such a wonderful presentation. Now, all of you know the before and after what happened for about 26, 7 years. What happened? Thank you, Tim, again. And also Ogawa family and Kusumoto family. I still remember all of the members in Chicago, and also Dr. Arai was here when I was in here, and also Reverend Alfred Tsuki came over to Chicago at Meadville to give a presentation about Konko faith while I was there. He gave us so powerful, meaningful presentation for the students at Meadville. Thank you, Alfred Sensei. About a couple of hours ago, I was welcomed to Konko Faith with Aloha Spirit. So now, I am more strengthened and have a power from within. Now, good morning, everyone. I am Kyoji Konko. This is my after's Kyoji Konko. He's here after 26 years of absence, anyway. As Tim introduced me, I'm an assistant minister at the Central Mediation Hall of Konko Kyo. And I am very grateful and honored to be able to hear at the keynote speaker for Konko Church's North America Conference this year. As all of you know, our conference has been held the host church of the West Coast. And this year is the first time we have holding it in the Middle West here in Chicago. My second hometown, Chicago, with Aloha Spirit. I am very grateful to all of the members of the Konko Churches of Chicago and Toronto for working hard to organize this event. I particularly want to thank Reverend Amy Uzunoe-Chin, Chief Administrative Minister of KCNA, and Reverend Rodney Yano, and Ms. Jennifer Tashiro, coordinators for youth adults and young adults and youth program, youth camp, respectively, for the all youth work organizing our annual event. I am very grateful for their support. Thank you. Also, before I start my presentation, I would like to thank all of you who prayed for us in Japan during the past month when we experienced unprecedented flooding from torrential rain. Our area of Japan was particularly affected, with over 200 people left dead and over 3,300 families homeless. The CONCO headquarters have been very busy these past weeks supporting emergency services. We even converted the basement of the Central Meditation Hall and into an evacuation shelter. Even through the Central Meditation Hall is on a small mountain, we were not affected by it. Marginalized. Kami has surely been protecting for us. Now, let us start into my presentation. My prayer is that all of you will switch the light on and keep it on. Let us start with this simple game. Do all of you have your cell phone out to Kafu? If you do, please input the number up here, up there. I'll give you 1 minute. Please help each other. So after you leave the question, please choose an answer. Now, let us begin. Please answer honestly. You do not have to consult with anyone else except your heart. So please choose the color of each. So question 2 of 10 now goes, I think Chicago. What? What do you think? Amazing. So now, 3 of 10. I love. By the way, I ate on the day I arrived in Chicago. I ate natto at Chicago anyway.
Someone likes that?
Question 6, do you pray before you drive? I have heard a number of students who pray during their kafu. I don't know how many of you, know that. Thank you. Do you pray at work? Zelda.
Oh.
was taking. Okay. From the result, interesting. So I'm using these results throughout my presentation. Okay. Now, in Konkokyo, it is often said that divine blessings depend on your own heart. I think that divine favor actually depends on how earnestly you try to deepen your relationship with Kami. Your connection with Kami cannot be made by your head. It needs to follow from your heart. And knowing Kami, having a deep relationship with Kami, is central to our faith. But what does it mean to know Kami? It has been said that your body is a shrine that Kami invites inside of you. This is what we mean when we refer to having the heart of Kami. It means that through practice faith, we become aware of Kami's presence inside of us. We become more attuned to Kami-sama's divine guidance, which frees us of our self-centered existence and enables us to embrace a Kami-centered mindset. To have a Kami-centered mindset is to become one with Kami in a mutually fulfilling relationship. We can harness the energy that flows from the universe, which is Kami, and that enables us to do Kami's work on our daily lives. We can learn to embrace hardships in this life as opportunities for spiritual growth, and this in turn helps us to improve our lives and the lives of those around us. The Kami-centered mindset is the light of inner happiness that shines from within. How do we create the Kami-centered mindset? Well, today, I'd like to share that with all of you by my first introducing you to the three sources and four pillars. Next, talking about the light turning off. And finally, the importance about sharing the light. So, let me start by introducing to all of you the three streams and the four pillars. As you probably know, I grew up attending services and working alongside my father, the fifth Konko-sama, observing the dedication and commitment that my father brought to his role in the church made me realize how interconnected we all are. About 10 years ago, I conceived of a metaphor to represent how the Central Meditation Hall connects with other churches and their followers around the world. I call it the three sources. I can see the Central Meditation Hall as a well, the services as a spiritual spring, sustained at all Konko churches. There is an invisible stream flowing from this spiritual source and connecting the Central Meditation Hall with each church. When we ask for mediation, if another spiritual source flow into our households, filling our daily lives with divine presence. Do you remember the question from Kafut? 29 of you said, you pray before you drive. 29? Yes. And 35 of you said you pray at work. And 42 of you said you pray at home. Well, this is a third source. Yes, we can access the third source from wherever we are, work or school, or simply around town, as we go about our daily lives. How do we access it? Through prayer, of course. Whenever and wherever we are, through prayer, we can seek mediation and connect ourselves back to the central mediation hall. If we get so distracted by our daily lives that we forget to seek mediation regularly, our access to that spiritual well dries up, and we lose our connection to God. This limits our ability to cultivate the mindset of appreciation that leads to inner happiness. Through daily prayer and mediation, we can reset our spiritual focus, keeping the heart of coming and divine guidance accessible. To quote my father, the fifth Kongosama, "The joy of faith is the same as the joy felt in our daily lives, because practicing faith is an integral part of our lives. Receiving mediation, appreciating the divine blessings in our daily lives, and expressing the joy that comes from practicing faith, they all are connected. The joy of faith is the ultimate fulfillment for those who seek the true happiness. This spiritual spring, this bountiful source of divine blessings and favor, is not limited to the central mediation hall. All churches can reach deeply and directly into this source. This applies to North American, Hawaii, Korean, in Japan diocesan offices, and all the churches throughout the world. Now, let me explain about the four pillars. It is easy to remember if you imagine four pillars holding up the foundation of our faith. The first pillar is daily prayer. The second pillar is mediation. The third pillar is goyo, or giving your time and energy to supporting the church. And the fourth pillar is gratitude. When we keep our spiritual lives balanced with the four pillars, we can continuously ignite our relationship with God. This is a way to keep the light of faith shining brightly, that the love of Kami can spread throughout our communities and beyond. We need Kami, but don't forget that Kami needs us as well. This is one of the most unique attributes of Kongo Kyo. No other religion has this attribute. Kami relies on us to listen and respond to Kami's sacred guidance with acts of kindness. And let us not underestimate the depth of love that our divine Pierre has for all of us. When we can fully appreciate how sincerely the Founder focuses his prayer on our behalf, we can connect more completely with God. It is when this happens that the light inside of us shines most brightly. Kami continuously plays for us. Whether or not we work to keep Kami in our hearts, whether or not we experience a spiritual awakening for our relationship, our lives are touched and guided by Kami's love. Know that Kami's love for you is deep and enduring, and that Kami patiently waits for you to opened the door to Kami's presence. During the next couple of days, we will describing how to smile from within through the power of positive talking. Today, I'd like to share some stories to help you understand how we can create a dynamic relationship with Kami through the way we embrace a Kami-centered mindset in our daily lives. In the Kafut, 40 of you said that you pray for others. Also, 33 of you said that you knew you were prayed for. I want you to know that you are being prayed for everywhere, every day. Please allow me to share with you a story about the Concord Church of Fukushima. My great uncle, the fourth Konko-sama's younger brother, Reverend Goyu Konko, established the Funabashi Church near Tokyo. So, this is the late Reverend Goyu Konko, who is the younger brother of the fourth Konko-sama. And on the right hand, this is the Konko Church of Funabashi. Here in Tokyo. And his son, Eiyo Sensei, became the head of the Concord Church of Fukushima. He's the Reverend Eiyo Fukushima. So Goyo Sensei's son, and this is the picture of Concord Church of Fukushima, located in Fukushima Prefecture. And that church is about 300 kilometers, or 186.4 miles from 4 miles north from the Funabashi Church. A two-hour train ride, Eiyo Sensei became head minister of the church on June 27, 2005. 5 years later, during the grand ceremony, they marked Eiyo Sensei's fifth anniversary as head minister. For this occasion, Eiyo Sensei asked his father to please give the sermon. When his father came for the ceremony, it was the first time he had ever been in Fukushima. He opened his sermon with the statement that, I have been worshiping with the Fukushima Church every day since June 27, 2005. Remember, June 27th, is the day when Eiyo Sensei first took over as head minister there. Eiyo Sensei was surprised to hear that, because until then, he had been under the impression that I had been leading the church there all the time by myself. But upon hearing his father's statement, he realized that even though his father had been living far away, during 5 years, he actually had been worshiping with the Fukushima Church in spirit through his daily prayers. Eiyo Sensei was filled with gratitude that his father had been supporting the Fukushima Church in this way, because he understood that through his father's connection to the current Konko-sama, the church is receiving spiritual guidance from not only his father, but all the preceding Konko-sama back to the founder himself. Our headquarters, Rush Hall, extends its support, prayers, and over to 1,500 plus churches. This makes up the source of interconnected mediation that unites us, and we are blessed with divine favor. Goyo Sensei, in turn, was filled with gratitude for his son taking on the sacred responsibility, continuing policy at the Fukushima Church, and he quietly communicated that appreciation through his daily prayers, and thus strengthened the connection between the Central Mediation Hall and the Fukushima Church. No matter where we are, our prayers can be heard, and our sincere desires will reach all the way to the Central Mediation Hall, where the founders and their successors can intercede on our behalf to ask for coming divine blessings. This is the source of interconnected mediation that unites us. Thus, the four pillars are a means by which we switch the light on, practicing faith in our everyday life, living the teachings, and putting our faith into action is how we keep the light on. And there are also those whose prayers for us are aiding in keeping the light on. We need to switch the light on and keep it on. But the light does turn off too. Just as our faith helps us keep the light on, the light can easily turn off, especially when our mind becomes negative. And there are many ways this can happen. Let me start by asking all of you some questions, and be honest, raise your hand, please. If you love to clean the toilet, good, Subarashi. How many of you love yard work? Good. How about washing dishes? Many hands. Laundry, ready? Folding the laundry. Okay, sometimes the daily mundane in our lives can actually turn the lights off in our daily lives if we have the wrong mindset. Let me share with you a story about how one minister turned that around. A few years ago, a minister, Reverend Tsunami, gave a sermon at the Central Mediation Hall, and he brought up the problem he had been having with laundry at home. It seems that his children weren't helping with the laundry. He said that he had been getting frustrated to the point of anger that his children won't help to hold the laundry. But he was able to redirect his feelings after he recalled something that our founder once said to Masajiro Sugita. If the sun doesn't shine, laundry won't dry. That made Tsunami Sensei think about how life-giving earth itself. The sun is a natural, yet a divine blessing, because we rely on it to dry our clothes. Inspired by his insight, he invited his son to help him fold the laundry while they talked about the grace attached to his simple household task. His son was so taken by deeper appreciation for the chore that he held the laundry quite willingly without complaint. Afterwards, his son began volunteering to do the laundry without anything having to ask for his help. In his sermon, Tsunami Sensei went on to expand upon his story. He talked about how everything around us is provided through Kamisama's grace as manifested in the workings of the universe. Where does a toilet come from? A toilet comes from the earth. Our curls, our dishes, our chairs, they all are shaped with the materials that the earth abundantly provides us with. You might think that garbage is worthy of appreciation because we cast it aside as useless. But that isn't really the case. If we can feel gratitude for every garbage, our connection to Kami will become closer because every time we feel gratitude for simple things in our lives, we are actually appreciating Kami and all that Kami has provided for us. This enables Kami's grace to expand to touch our lives even more deeply. Let me share one more story about how the mundane tasks in our lives can help keep the light on. There was a woman who was 75 years old, and she made a pilgrimage to headquarters. After worshiping, she went to the founder's gravesite, which is just up to the mountain from the hall. She was frail. So as she made her way up the stone stairs, and while grasping the handrail for support, a group of women from her church followed behind her. A staff member from our administrative office was walking up to the gravesite too, but he stayed a respectful distance behind their group. When she reached the top of the staircase, she removed her hand from the railing and noticed that it had become quite dirty. The staff member saw this and felt responsible. He thought someone from headquarters should have cleaned the railing. And worried about she might react. Would she need to wash her hands? Would she be angry? Perhaps she would think the staff at the headquarters weren't maintaining the facility well. At that moment, the woman noticed the dirt on her hand. Her reaction was unexpected. Now, here's the question. How do you think the woman, right after she noticed her hand became dirt, one or two of you? How?
Gratitude?
Eh?
I mean, was she happy that she made the handrail a little bit cleaner?
Well, maybe. Okay. Her response was, with a smile, she said, "Oh, I cleaned the handrail." The other members of her group quietly smiled at her junior's response. The staff member who was observing them felt relieved, as his spirit had been lifted by a fresh spring breeze. Upon reflection, he felt that her response would be felt not only by the people there, but future generations who would be touched indirectly by her genuine Jesus' Spirit. Often the most common experiences in our daily lives provide us with an opportunity to share the life, share the genius benevolence of Kami with others. We also benefit much when we are able to feel a sense of gratitude for even the most mundane tasks in our daily lives. Coming here for this conference has required mental preparation, including one of my latest, least favorite experiences, dealing with our mental bureaucracy. How many of you enjoyed that moment? Raise your hand. I see that I am not alone. Well, since my third son, Keishi, decided to come with me for this year's conference, I needed to make sure that his passport was in order. I have traveled even finding it because we won't use it so often. Eventually, we found Keishi's passport, not only to realize that it had expired. I was searching for a proper pen because these forms require a black ink pen or they will be rejected. Keishi saw me trying to find a pen, so he reached into his pencil case and passed one to me. I was eager to get started, so I took it and began with all those tasks. Then I took the form to the passport office. I had to borrow a pen to add some information once I was there. The ink didn't look the same as the ink I had used, and I worried that the officials would make me rewrite the entire document again, but they said it was okay. They asked me if I had used indelible ink because that was required. I had no reason to believe otherwise, so I assured them I had. I was relieved to finally be finished with the task. The next day, however, I received a phone call from the passport office via cell phone while I was out doing errands. They said they were sorry to inform me that they couldn't process the passport because I had used an erasable ink pen. I was now required to resubmit the forms with a permanent ink pen. That evening, I went to the city office with Keishi and submitted the paperwork again, but on the way back home, I realized that I had forgotten to confirm with the clerk that everything was in order. I muttered to myself in my car that I should have double-checked everything. After all, we could not afford another delay. I chilled myself. Why did I do that? I kept saying that repeatedly with a small voice. Why didn't I do that? Why did I do that? Keishi was in the car with me, so I tried to hide how frustrated I was feeling. Gradually, I calmed down and decided not to waste my energy criticizing myself anymore. Now, let us review what happened in my heart. Through renewing the passport, I got emotional and blamed others, instead of recognizing that it was my fault, which of course it was. I turned my light off, switch off. I just wanted to finish the business as fast as possible, but blaming the clerk just made me even more distressed. switches still off. Darkness. If I had been able to harness the light of Camille's heart earlier, I would not have needed to blame. Instead, I'd have been able to show appreciation to that official at the passport office. The application might have inspired her to work harder on my behalf. Perhaps you have noticed the erasable ink error and saved me the inconvenience of having to resubmit the application. I'd have been easy to feel gratitude in my heart for the opportunity to get the passport renewed for my son, because I was actually so very excited to be able to visit you here in Chicago. Even though bureaucracy is hard to negative, it was still a privilege for me to be able to through the process. It would have been better if I had kept a positive mindset. It is said that your body is a shrine for Kami. Invite Kami to live inside of you. This was said by one of the founders' pastors, the late Reverend Norio Sato of Geiji Church. If you have Kami in your heart, there is no room left for blaming. Kami is pure benevolence, a force of compassion, and boundless hope. When you adapt an attitude of appreciation, especially in the most difficult moments, you invite Kami to fill your heart with light, and that light shines outwards to touch the hearts of others. In this way, you become the stone in the proverbial palm that sends ripples of happiness around the world. Kami's greatest desire is for you to be a participant in making the world a kinder place. Cultivating the mindset of appreciation is the precursor to fulfilling this deeper spiritual purpose, which is a mutual fulfillment of Kami and humanity. Regardless of where you are, what you are doing, what happens to you, you now know that is it important to not have a poverty or victim mindset, and to find a way to switch the light on and keep it on. Meditation can definitely help you with that. Before I talk about sharing the light, I want to do an activity. I'll give you 1 minute to do this activity. Turn your papers over and you will see a blank bunch of lines. Write down as many names of the people, animals you love and care about. And after 1 minute up, flip the paper over. No adding after 1 minute. Ready? Begin. Okay, 1 minute has ended. I'll come back to this list later. Our divine parent of the universe wishes that we humans help others just as one ourselves help each other in our bodies. I saw some interesting scientific research regarding this. Our cells produce a hormone that reduces inflammation. The researchers wonder if perhaps that concept might extend to people. They studied three groups of people suffering from inflammation to test their hypothesis. Group one was held to enjoy life, to pursue hobbies, to eat their favorite foods, basically to do whatever they liked. Group two was told to try hard to be useful to society by doing voluntary activities such as cleaning trash off the streets. The only restriction was that they were not allowed to do anything that was directly related to other people. Group three was told to be kind to people, to give generously to others, and to make sure they did so at least three times a day. The scientists measured the level of inflammation in the participants before and after the experiment. Which group do you think showed the most improvement? Any guesses?
Three.
That's right. Group number three, the ones who gave generously to others at least three times a day. We humans have evolved to help other people. Our survival depends upon altruistic behavior. Our genes reward us for helping others by ensuring our survival. They are part of our evolutionary history. Acts of kindness and generosity not only sustain us spiritually and emotionally through deepening our connection to God, but they physically strengthen our body as well. Helping others is our deepest purpose in life. And so Kami has designed us to thrive when it embraces this sacred calling. When we commit our lives to serving others, we release the light of Kami, healing the psychic wounds that disrupt humanity from realizing the deeper spiritual potential. In essence, we become Kamis in this life, for the heart of Kami results in all of us as it awaits expression through our good works. But please don't get the idea that sick or downtrodden people are showing evidence of selfish character. We should not blame vulnerable people for immoral behavior just because they are suffering in this life. Their suffering is beyond a simple understanding. In fact, their divine purpose might very well be to inspire us to be better and more compassionate people. The main point that goodness can protect us in ways that might not be obvious. It is a divine gift worthy of our deepest appreciation. We have talked about using mindset of appreciation to help us with emotional regulation in challenging moments in life. And we have also talked about the importance of appreciating the simplest objects and experiences with our daily lives, and how this appreciation can extend to acts of kindness, cooperation, or altruism that touch the hearts of others. But how might appreciation work when we apply it to the spiritual life of the church? I want to share the story about a boy whose genius heart moved me. Only one person per year could be nominated for a prestigious university at this boy's school. He really wanted to be the lucky one selected. But he went to church to ask for mediation regarding the scholarship. He said he had a conflict in his heart. He explained that even though he wanted that scholarship, he knew of another student who was desperately desired the honor. That student too had worked hard for it. If he knew that there is another student who wanted the scholarship, what or how would you pray? In this boy's case, instead of asking the mediator to pray for his own success, he prayed for the other boy's success. The mediator asked, "Are you willing for the other student to be nominated instead of you?" The boy replied, "Yes, please pray for my classmate. I know that if he isn't chosen, he will be devastated and his mother will be too. But if I don't get in, I'll be okay because I have the church incoming. They don't have that. So please pray that my friend gets that scholarship." What a wonderful person he showed himself to be. He demonstrated a positive attitude with a kind heart, with gratitude and patience. He was able to regard the feelings and circumstances of others with compassion and respect. Even at such a young age, he had learned the value of being humble and generous in spirit. But the kindness in his heart was multiplied many times over when he chose to seek mediation to submit his deepest desire to Gongo-sama and founder for their divine assistance. Enlisting the power of Kami extended the protection of the boy's faith to the other student and his family. Whether or not the other student got the scholarship is not relevant at the moment. What is important is he and his family can benefit from Kami's grace. And boy seeking mediation surely was able to feel released of the burden of worry about the other student's fate. No doubt he went home feeling more peaceful in his heart. The point here is that the boy has the church and coming. I think all of you too have your own church and connection with coming. Through your daily, through your family or close ones. Church has mediation, which is the core of our faith. Mediation is a powerful tool that can put your heart at peace, and it also has the added benefit for spreading the light of Kami throughout our community of believers and beyond. Now, turn your seat over and look at all the names of the people on that list. please raise your hand if you can honestly say that you have prayed for all of those people on your paper every day. Please raise your hand. Oh, wonderful. Thank you. Please raise your hand if you can honestly say that you have sought mediation on behalf of all those people every day. Please raise your hand. Oh, thank you. If you are unable to hesitate to raise your hand, now you have a list. Now you'll be able to pray for all of them and more. We need to practice faith and receive mediation in order to help ourselves and others too. And please repeat after me to switch the light on and keep it on. Please get more energy. Switch the light on
and keep it on.
First, I talked about the importance of mediation and faith through three sources and four pillars. Through mediation, our prayer becomes a two-way street. Humanity and Kami are able to walk the path together. And as I have shared, the Central Mediation Hall, local churches, and other our households, all three are connected through mediation and our sincere prayer. Next, through several stories, when we negative or unexpected things were occurred, how easy the light turns off when we have negative and victim mindset. And in such negative circumstances, I demonstrated that how we are able to switch it back on. And finally, I spoke about how we can share the light with others, fulfilling our deeper spiritual purpose, which is the mutual fulfillment of Kami and humanity. Many of you know what the name of Konko means in Japanese. It means golden light. The present Konko-sama spoke at a KCNA conference in Santa Barbara back in 1972. He said, "A light of faith should be handed down from generation to generation." In my prayer, that you keep your light on and share it with others so that they too can experience the hope and joy that awaits all who embraces Kami in their hearts. So finally, we come to the end, and I would like all of you to join me in saying what is on the screen, and I pray you will always keep this in your heart and remind each other of this from here on forth. Ready?
Switch the light on and keep it on.
Thank you very much.